Welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church in Sacramento, California. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Terrell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor John continues the series entitled, Paul's Letter to the Ephesians. The letter to the church in Ephesus is nearly 2,000 years old, but it was written with clarity and divine insight that no modern writing has been able to match. In this first chapter, the Apostle Paul wanted to teach the basic doctrines of the Christian faith, beginning with predestination. This topic was important to people coming out of idol worship, such as with the goddess Diana, or Artemis as she is more commonly known, in which he detailed the relationship between God the Father and Jesus the Son, along with the great inheritance of every believer in Christ. He finished the chapter by teaching that Jesus is the supreme ruler of all believers in the world, and rules with such great power that no act of the devil can be compared. This message is entitled, The Greatness of Christ. Now, let's go to the sanctuary and join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church on November 13th, 2011. And I'm glad that you're here today in the congregation. And I'm glad for those of you that are joining us around the world, wherever you might be. So welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church. Let's stand for prayer. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank and praise you right now that we can gather here today in the mighty, powerful name of Jesus. We thank you, Father God, for the beautiful worship service we had here today, Lord. Beautiful songs, Father God, that were simply birthed by the Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord, that we have voices to sing, hands to raise, that we can praise you, because you are worthy to be praised. And open a word to us right now. Father God, we might live and live victorious. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You may be seated. I'd like for you to turn with me to the book of Ephesians. Actually, it's not the book of Ephesians, but it's a letter to the Ephesians. And this is my second installment. Last week we talked about the city, the church, and today we're going to get in and look at the letter itself. And I want you to think about this now as we look upon these words. In Ephesus, 1,900 some odd years ago, they had houses, but they had no electricity. They had no running water. They didn't have any glass windows. They had some kind of other coverings, something they had, something light that they had just made of fabric. And they have no central air and heat. They had no bathrooms. You had to go outside in a house by itself. And life was very simple. No lights. There was no electricity, oil lamps, no cell phones, of course, no internet, no computers. Life was extremely simple. People at that time did not have a highly educated background. Some of them might know how to do adding and subtracting and multiplication and division, but that was about it. History-wise, they didn't know that much. And yet, when you read this letter, written by Paul, to a primitive society in our standards, this letter is above anything that anyone can write today. I don't care, novels, books, whatever it is. They can never match this. This is supernatural reading and writing. In the first verse, Paul identifies himself. He says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. What does the word apostle mean? The Greek word means to send out, to be sent out. Another word we have today is missionary. And Paul simply identified himself as a missionary of Jesus Christ. He had not selected this job by himself, but he had been called according to the will of God. And he was not bashful. He didn't say, you know, please excuse me, I happen to be an apostle. He said, I'm an apostle by the will of God. And this is how you and I need to be today when we talk to people, you meet people. You need to tell them, I am a Christian. I'm born again. I'm baptized in the Holy Spirit on my way to heaven, shouting victory. This is how we should present ourselves. And then in verse number 2, he says this, grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, we have a bad habit when we write emails today. We sometimes don't even put a name on it. We just simply start writing in. But wouldn't you say it'd be nice to start an email with this? Grace be to you. Peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he said, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. For the last 4 or 5 weeks, we have been praying here in our prayer meetings that the anointing would increase, that the presence would increase, and that the gifts of the Holy Spirit will begin to operate. Matter of fact, in the prayer meeting today before the service, we were led in a prayer and taken away all intimidations. And I believe it was answered here today. We sang with more freedom. And I want to encourage you today, for example, we had an exhortation, a word for the Lord by a member of the congregation. But let me say this to you. If you have a word in the future and you want to prophesy or speak, don't speak from down there because the people that are watching us worldwide cannot hear what you say. Simply just move up here and say, I got a word for the Lord. Don't be intimidated. But please don't speak from the audience because they cannot pick you up. And people are simply, there's a pause and nothing is happening. We get blessed here, but they cannot be blessed. So in the future, I hope that more people will prophesy, speak in tongues, give a word, or maybe have a healing for someone that needs to be healed. Because look again what he said in verse number 3. Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Now that's a good way to start an email. I would like that. Next we're going to look upon predestination. I'm excited about this. Let's read verses 4 through 9. According as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself according to the good pleasure of his will. If you look in verse 4, it says, before the foundation of the world. What does that mean? Here's what it means. God is eternal. He has always existed. He has no beginning. He has no end. Where God lives, we don't know. Who lives there with him? We don't know. What does he do? We don't know. But we know he lives outside this creation. Some time ago, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit sat down and said, we are going to create us a little creation. Now, I'm trying to use human terminology here. We have computers today, and people say, well, we invented them. Wrong. We discovered them. All the technology that we have is created by God. He has technology that is more vast, more advanced than we can even begin to think about in 10,000 years. I'm picturing of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, standing someplace in a throne room in heaven, having a huge screen on a wall someplace. And God the Father said, this is what I want. On the screen comes up a universe. And his son said, well, let's move it this way. And there they stand, and they design this from the very beginning to the very end. Every human being that is going to be born, they simply see it projected up on a screen. God can see in the past, in the future, in the present. God sees everything at one time continually. And so for the foundation of this creation, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit simply looked at everything, designed everything, and then said, let's do it. And they did. If you look at verse number 5 now, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. What does it mean to be predestinated? When God looked upon you and me before the creation, he simply saw us conceived in our mother's womb, growing up as a little child, as teenagers, adults, elderly, and dying. And God saw each one of us, and he knew, this person will accept me, this person will reject me. And those that he knew that would accept him, he put much more work in than those he did not. You might be sitting here today, you might be out watching, and he says, well, you don't know the agony I've gone through, all the difficulties I've gone through. God knew in advance. God has a plan for you. And in the midst of your tribulations and difficulties, his hand was there, even before you accepted him. That's what that means. And then in verse number 6, he says this, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he has made us accepted in the beloved. The most difficult thing we have to do with people after go through deliverance is to show them that they need to love themselves. If we would take a survey here today, I would probably say that probably most of you here would not think very highly of yourself, lest you would love each other or actually love yourself. But this is what it says here, that when God saved us, it was to be the praise of the glory of his grace. If you are walking around and saying, you know, I'm beating myself up, I'm no good, I can't do this, I'm nothing, you know, I'm this and that, you're not bringing praise to God. You're bringing complaints to God. Who made you? God made you. Does God make junk? I've never seen him make junk so far. And he never will. So begin to love yourself. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. We are washed in the blood, forgiven, wherein he has abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. He's given us an abundance of wisdom, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he has purposed in himself. Now, I want you to chew on these verses later on today, but turn me right now to the Gospel of John, chapter 1. That's the Gospel of John, the first chapter. I'm going to read these verses here. We've been there before, but these are powerful verses. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now, you read that. The Word, Greek word here is logos. If you look at verse number 14, we have an identification on the Word. What is the Word? And the Word was made flesh, dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The Word is Jesus. Let's go back and read Jesus now instead of Word. In the beginning was Jesus, and Jesus was with God, and Jesus was God. Wow, that's powerful. The same Jesus was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, Jesus, and without him was not anything made that was made. Jesus is the creator. In Jesus was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in darkness, and the darkness comprehended not. And then we go down to verse number 10. He was in the world. The world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He, Jesus, came unto his own. His own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. Look in verse 12. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Ask yourself a question there. Have you believed on his name? Have you received Christ? If you have, you simply have become the son of God, or a child of God, a daughter of God. We are not divine, but we are his children. We have been made born again. Now, if you walk around and you say, well, I can't love myself because I'm not worth to be loved, look at this verse. But as many as he received, to them gave the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. If I am a child of the King, I really should begin to love myself. He made me, I'm his. And then turn to Romans chapter 8. That's Romans, the 8th chapter. You know, so many of us, we walk around and we say, well, I've done this and I've done that, you know, because of this or that. I want you to notice that you are walking in his will, if you like it or not. And when you are not doing what he wants you to do, God has, for the least stubborn people, he has 2x4s. Those that are more stubborn, he has 2x6s. And the really stubborn, he has 6x6s. But let me tell you this, God will get your attention one way or the other. Guaranteed. And I tell you this, there's one time you will be on time. You know what it is? At your funeral, you will be on time. Now, Romans 8, if you pick it up in verse number 28. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. That verse is kind of strange. Let me try to illustrate that for you. God spoke to me about a couple of months ago that I'm supposed to do some major speaking to the Scandinavian countries. And I got a message that I thought I was going to preach, and God gave me another message. And then I couldn't do it because the person helped me couldn't do it. So finally we set it up for Wednesday night this week. And so I got all my stuff together. I read it over. I prayed over it. Came down to church. Laid everything out here in the foyer. And I was just looking over my notes and says, now I need my glasses. I need my glasses. Where are my glasses? They are home. That's about 30 miles away. Now, I stood in the foyer here, and you know what my first feeling was? I wanted to kick the... You ever been there? You know, my wife was saying, calm down. I said, how could I be so stupid? How could I be so stupid? Man, I was bent out of shape. Now, you see, I got other people around, you know, so you got to be nice. You got to be bent out of shape nice. So I said, okay, we do it another time. So I drove home. Now, during the night, as God was speaking to me, I realized that I had, in my thought pattern, gone a way he didn't want me to go. So I realized, as he laid out for me, I don't want you to do it this way. This is the way I'm going to have you do it. I realized that the day on that Wednesday, I was so busy in my mind that God could not speak to me. So he simply said to the Holy Spirit, have him forget his glasses. We stop him. And then when he's calmed down, we talk to him. Romans 8:28. Let me read it to you again. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. You're driving down the highway, suddenly your radiator breaks, busted up, smoke is coming up, and you know, you simply say, now, oh God, I can't afford this. God, what's your purpose in this? My first question is, God, is there a repair shop that needs my money? Is there a place? What's the story here? But I want you to notice that regardless what happened to you, if you love the Lord, he will work something good out. Guaranteed. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Now he wants to conform us to his image. And to do that, he got to clean up our mouth. He got to change our thinking. It's a lot of work. And guess what? God can only work when you are under stress. Because you see, when everything is fine, the sun is shining, it's nice and warm, you got money in a bank, everything is flowing, you know, there is no bad things coming out of your heart. But when you suddenly run out of money, something happens. Pressure begins to build. Whatever is inside of you will begin to come up. And that's what God is saying. We need to look at this, this, and that. You want to get out of a pressure cooker? Change fast. And say, Lord, teach me fast. I'm not going to be stubborn. And then we read this. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. Whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. What should we then say to do things if God be for us? Who can be against us? You and I are predestined. God has laid out a road for you and me to walk. And then in verse number 10, we come into his relationship. Let's read verse number 10 back in Ephesians now. Ephesians 1:10. That in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. Now we need to know the relationship here between God the Father, God the Son. It's laid out in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. That's 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter. And we pick it up here in verse 22. And what I'm going to do now is I'm not going to have he and you, but I'm going to put in the names. 1 Corinthians 15, 22. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ and his coming. Then comes the end, when Jesus shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when Jesus shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. For Jesus must reign till Jesus has put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that should be destroyed is death. For God has put all things under Jesus' feet. But when he says all things are put under Jesus, it is manifest that God is accepted, which he put all things under Jesus. And when all things should be subdued under Jesus, then shall his Son also himself be subject unto him, the Father, that put all things under Jesus, that God may be all in all. God is one, yet God is three. God the Father is in heaven. The Holy Ghost is moving. But Jesus is the ruler. And Jesus will be the ruler until after the great white throne judgment, when you will see God the Father, Jesus the Son, God the Holy Spirit. There will something come together into one in the most glorious appearance, full power that you and I cannot stand. We cannot live. We cannot exist in full power with our human bodies. But when we have been resurrected, we have our divine bodies, our new bodies, not divine, but our new heavenly bodies, then we will be able to see the Father in his full glory. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit in one, full force. What is the inheritance of the saints? Well, look in verse number 11. In 1 Corinthians, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things after the counsel of his own will. You and I have an inheritance. And you find an inheritance in Romans 8:15. Turn back to Romans 8, verse number 15. These are wonderful verses. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, But you've received the spirit of adoption where we cry, Abba, Father. Fear is not from God, that's from the devil. The Spirit itself bear witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we might be also glorified together. For I reckon his suffering at this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which will be revealed in us. But look in verse number 17. And if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. We are joint heirs with Jesus Christ. That means that everything that God has given to the Son, he has given to us. Healing, joy, peace, abundant life. The list is long. Why don't we have that? Well, to have that, you got to walk with him. And most of us, we say, well, it's okay, God, but you know, Lord, I have my own life to live. He said, if you do, then I cannot bless you. Then we find the next thing, which is trusting and sealed by the Holy Spirit. Look in verse number 12. That we should be to the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ, in whom you also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. In him also, after you believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance, the redemption of purchased possession, unto the praise of his glory. Most of you do not know the financial setup at the time when this was written. But in the days of Paul here, they did not have checkbooks. They did not have bank cards or anything like this. They had cash, and they had letters of promise. And each person had a ring. And on that ring was a certain symbols. There was simply a mark that this is a person. So let's say that you went someplace, you want to do some business, and you would do the business. They would take a piece of paper. They would take some wax and heat it up and pour it on this paper, on this contract. You would take your ring and you would press it in, and that was a seal on that document that it was bona fide, that you had agreed to that. And this is what Paul says, that we have been sealed. Jesus took his ring and sealed each one of us, that we are saved. We have been redeemed, trusting and sealed by the Holy Spirit. Someday in the future, we're going to have the mark of the beast come on the scene. And there's going to be a lot of fear among people. But I want you to notice that on that day, if you're there all by yourself and you're facing an office, and you're told, are you going to take the mark of the beast? We have one ready for you here. We want to insert it under your skin, your hand, or your forehead. There's a time to simply say, sorry, I do not take the mark of the devil. I am sealed by the Holy Spirit. I have the mark of God in my forehead. Read the book of Revelation, it says several times that God has marked his people, he has sealed his people. If they say, well, we're going to kill you, you're going to, then some people say, go ahead. You know what you're going to do? You're going to send me to heaven. Wonderful. The sad thing is, you folks are going to go to hell. If you understand that you're sealed by the Holy Spirit, you will never, never again be afraid. maybe a year or 2 years ago. It was a Christian woman in Texas. And she's about maybe 35, 40 years old, maybe older. And a man broke into her house, and he was going to rob her and rape her. And she had no weapon. And she began to pray. And she began to proclaim that you cannot rape me. I'm a child of the king. The man got intimidated. And before long, she was reading from the Bible for him, praying with him for the next 24 hours. And eventually the man said, I am sorry. And he went out and surrendered to the police. I want you to think about this. If that woman would have panicked, screamed, and just rolled on the floor, she would have been raped. But you said, I'm a child of the king. You cannot touch me. We have power and authority. Let's use it in our daily lives. And then we go down to verse number 15. We come into some exhortations here now. I like these exhortations. Paul is giving thanks. Wherefore, I also have to heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints. Cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. Every one of us have touched people. There's a song that I like. It was sung by a group called A Vision, Greater Vision. And it's called Faces. And the story goes like this, that this man comes up into heaven. He stands before the throne room of God. And suddenly, he hears some kind of a song. And he heard Faces. And he turns around. And he sees all the people he touched in his lifetime standing behind him, thankful that he touched them. Last night, we had a Thanksgiving dinner here at Resurrection Life of Jesus Church. And as I was sitting here, I got up to give thanks. And a thought came to my mind as I looked upon table after table, that every one of you that were here last night, I know they were someone on here today, but you were here. Everyone, my wife and I, had talked with you, had prayed with you. Somehow we touched you. And the reason we had almost a full house here yesterday was because God used my wife and me to touch you in some way. Now, you have people that you have touched. There are people standing in line to be touched by you until you go home and be with Jesus. So why don't you do like Paul said here? He says, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. He was thankful to people he had touched. And then verse number 17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom of revelation in the knowledge of him. No curses. Paul didn't say you're not too good. He said this, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom of revelation in the knowledge of him. When you talk to people, bless them. Bless them. May God give you wisdom. May God give you health. May God guide you. Learn to bless people continually. The eyes of your understanding be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. Beautiful words, wonderful prayers here. That you may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. Last night, there was a couple here that we met probably 25 years ago. And I want to share the story with you very carefully. When a man came about 25 years ago, he was a Christian, he was trying to serve God, but his wife was not saved. And his wife was an alcoholic. She smoked and she cursed, went to the bars, and she was just a terrible person. They had some children. And the more he prayed and the more he sought God, the worse he got. And he simply lived in hell. And he talked to me years ago, and he said, you know, what can I do? What can happen? I said, well, let's pray. Let's pray that God would intervene. I believe that the first choice was for God to save that woman. But for some reason, that woman didn't want to get saved. So guess what God did? He took her life, and she died. Now the man was a widower. And what do you do when you lose your wife? You don't want to go into the slush pool, and some of you might not know what a slush pool is, but that's where the singers' clubs and churches are. Nowadays, you don't have to go to singers' groups. You know, you go on the internet, you know, find, you know, someone. But this guy prayed, and there was a woman out there that was godly, that loved the Lord, that wanted a Christian husband. And God put them together, and they married. They've been married now for 20-some-odd years. And this woman, when she looked at her husband, she admires him. She lifts him up. She ministered to him. And he lifts her up, ministers to her. And suddenly these people who had broken lives before suddenly were restored. And for the last 20 years have walked in the love of God and in the love of one another. They were here yesterday. And I was so happy to see them and rejoice with them. Can you have that? Yes, you can. But you see, what happened to us, we have what I call self-destructive spirits. Because there are unloving spirits that minister to us. And we are programmed to destroy rather than to build. So when God sends something nice into our lives, we can't accept it. It's too nice. I can't have that. You know, for years, my image was this: I'm a poor guy, and I need to drive old cars. And that's all my wife and I had, old cars. And you know, old cars, we simply every week, the old car was in the garage. And somebody said, why don't you get something better? I can't afford that. My wife corrected me and said, you can't, but God can. Don't limit God. Well, you know, we just don't have the money. So I drove old cars. Had no 1964 Ford Custom 500. 8 cylinders. No power steering, no air conditioning, tough car, and I drove that for over 30 years. And you know, there's some places, you know, where they have a nice car, you know, they bury them in the car, and I told people, I said, you know, they're going to bury me in this car, in my old 1966 Ford Custom 500. But something happened. I sold the car. Twice. I sold it to my nephew. And after he wrecked it, I bought it back. And then, you know, I fixed it up. Here it was again, driving my old 1966 Ford Custom, 500. But then I sold it again. And this time I didn't buy it back. It went to the state of Georgia someplace. Now, here's what God did. Somebody sent my wife and me a check for $15,000. And I told my wife, what are we going to do? She said, why don't you buy yourself a decent car? Well, that's a lot of money. Am I worth to have a car? So we bought a used Volvo. Been a nice car. Best car I ever had. I'd like to be buried in a car. It's a wonderful car. But you see, what I'm trying to share with you is this. Because of our poor self-image, we don't dare to think that God can bless us. Now, let's move on. Verse 19. And what is, I got to share one more thing with you. I had a life insurance. You ever had life insurance? You pay in or you pay in. And finally I decided, you know, that, hey, they're never going to cash it out. The economy's going down, you know, stuff like, get your money out when you can. Now, when I paid that life insurance, I saw in my mind a truck. I always wanted a diesel truck to pull a trailer. And I said, when I get my life insurance, cash that in, I'm going to buy a diesel truck. Then somebody rear-ended my wife's car. And you know, Mark looked at me and says, well, I guess that's the end of that. God said, buy her a new car, use your money for your truck. But Lord, my truck! So here she now, she drives a fairly new Toyota. I never did like Japanese cars, but they're good. I still don't like them, but they're good. Now, the reason I'm telling you this is that I had my sight on a truck. God said, you need something nice for your wife. Well, you got your Volvo. So here we are, Japanese, Swedish, going down the road. So far for cars. Now, verse 19. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us, word, who believe according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ, but he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. I want you to see verse number 19 now. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us word who believe according to the work of his mighty power? I want to share something else with you. Thursday night, I was here to make this taping for this message, which will go out on the internet next week. And as I finished speaking here for about a little bit over an hour, and I really challenged the powers, the satanic powers over the Scandinavian countries. We drove home. I was getting ready to go to bed. And suddenly, it was like someone hit me over the head, like this. And I lost all my ability to balance. And I started running into the wall. And I ran this way. I couldn't stand up. My wife came in and prayed for me, laid me down in bed. I laid in bed. You ever laid in bed and the bed is spinning, you know? Like a washing machine. And I realized, this is Satan. I rebuked it. We prayed over it. Cast the demon out. I got someone better. But you know, I was still woozy the next day. Walked around, and I said, in the name of Jesus, I'm not going to let this slow me down. I'm just going to do this or that. Saturday came. We had a nice dinner Saturday afternoon. Woke up in the morning, still woozy. You know, just walking around, you know, don't want to go this way or that way. You don't go this way. See? Then I took my blood pressure. That's the worst thing you can do. I realized my blood pressure was very elevated. And then the devil said, see, you're ready for a stroke. Here's a stroke coming. So I took my blood pressure on this side, checked it on this side, averaged it out. Okay. Now, I had a choice. Now, here's a humor of God. We needed three tables down here, some chairs. And I thought somebody else was going to take care of that. So then, about 2 hours before we were going to go down here, the word came, we need three tables and we need some chairs. I'm still woozy. So I said, okay, all right. In the name of Jesus, here we go. So I simply went out, had a couple of guys help me. Here I was, trucking tables, loading chairs, putting them in, you know, hurrying up. Walked in the house, and I'm not woozy anymore. Wow, that's nice. God healed me. Doing great this morning. We're doing great tomorrow. Now, I could have simply said this. Well, since I'm a little bit over 7 years old, haven't seen a doctor for 15 years, maybe I should go to the emergency, you know, and have them check me out. I think if I'd have done that, I would have been laying in some bed, you know, over the weekend, you know, just recuperating, you know, just going. But I decided this, that I was going to go to Dr. Jesus. And I got so mad at the devil that he messed with me. So let me read again to you now from verse 19. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe according to the work of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him up from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. If you got problems in your body, begin to release the power of the Holy Ghost. Simply say, I'm going to release the exceeding powers of Christ into my body right now. And body, you line up. And then, verse number 21. This is my Jesus. I don't know who Jesus you have, but this is my Jesus. Far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named. Not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. Have you seen those verses before? Jesus, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in the world to come. That's my Jesus. Powerful. Very powerful. And has put all things on his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that fills all in all. Who is the head of this church? The Lord Jesus Christ. Who owns this place? The Lord Jesus Christ. Who runs this place? The Lord Jesus Christ. This is what God wants to do in your life. That you come to the place that you simply make him Lord, Master, King, Ruler. We sing a song, He is Lord. That's a beautiful, powerful song. He is Lord. We're going to do something right now. Yuri, can you go to the piano? I need you. Jason, I need you. I need you, Bill. Come on up here. We're going to pray with a song first. Just come on up here and stand by me. Joanne, come on up, quick. We're going to sing this song, He is Lord. Get me a key. I don't want you to stand. Let's proclaim that right now. Gather on his mic.
He is Lord. He is Lord. He has risen from the dead and he is Lord. Every knee shall Lord, you're my Lord. You have risen from the dead and you're my Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
We're going to sing it one more time here. When we sing that song, think about the mighty power of Christ. Apply it to your life. If you need a healing today, apply it to your life. And say right now, Lord, Lord, search through my body. You are my Lord and Savior. And he will heal you right now where you stand. Let's sing it.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
You're my Lord. You're my Lord. Have risen from the dead and you're my Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
My Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you right now for this moment we have here. And Lord, as we open the altars today, Father God, as the altars have opened of Resurrection Life of Jesus Church, let the people stream forward to be prayed for today, Lord. Amen. Let there be healings.
Yes, Heavenly
Let there be rededication. Father God, touch your people.
Yes.
And if you're watching us and you says, well, I'm not even born again, I'm not even saved, all you have to say is, my Heavenly Father, forgive me my sins. Jesus, I believe that you're the Son of God. Jesus, be my Lord and Savior. Jesus,
yes.
Come on in.
Yes.
Come on in,
yes.
Jesus, and
yes.
Save me. And he will, in Jesus' name, write us, call us, contact us. The altars have opened right now. Elders and deacons are here. You come. As you will, God will meet with you right now.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's Ten Commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past. And there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions. So act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Terrell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. Been listening to Pastor John S. Terrell of Resurrection Life of Jesus Church in Sacramento, California. This message was the second part in the series, Paul's Letter to the Ephesians, and was entitled, The Greatness of Christ. The believers in Ephesus came out of idol worship, and the topic of predestination was important to them. Paul detailed the relationship between God the Father and Jesus the Son, along with the great inheritance of every believer in Christ. As such, we are to bring praise to God through our lives because we have trusted in Christ for our salvation and been sealed by the Holy Spirit. Paul also taught that Jesus is the supreme ruler of all believers in the world, ruling with such great power that no act of the devil can even come close. Our God is indeed awesome and far above every principality, power, and dominion in this world. God has appointed Jesus to be in charge of all things, and there is nothing which is impossible for God. It is our hope that you are beginning to understand God's exceeding greatness which He has wrought in Christ Jesus and bestows toward those who believe. This message is available on cassette, CD, and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1316. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can learn more about Pastor Terrell's ministry, read insightful articles, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the toll-free number in the United States is 1-888-708-3232. That's 888-708-3232. For calls from outside the U.S., the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.